And then Dr. Ola Vinquist and a multidisciplinary group of collaborators at the Karolinska Institute in Sweden are applying for a grant to study Durkheim's disease. He's really hard to communicate with. He never emails me back. I emailed him my part of the grant, and I never heard anything, so I'm hoping that they submit it. And then I'm also working on a questionnaire and a database for Durkheim's disease. Actually, we're going to do all of fat disorders because we don't have a database. And I don't feel like using one of the industry-sponsored databases. I feel like we should kind of keep our own. And so I published a questionnaire on Durkheim's disease in 2007, and we're going to have those people answer one set of questions, and then we have the rest of it for everybody, and then we're going to take... You, at the end of it, you just check, do you want to be part of the database? Yes or no? Check. And you'll be given a number, and we will make this database, and we'll take information out of it that we want, but there's going to be so much information, we thought we would open it up to other investigators. So we could say, here's a whole bunch of data on people with fat disorders. Do you have any questions you might want to answer? And then they just have to submit a very quick IRB protocol, because you would be de-identified, they wouldn't know your identity, and we'd give them the data, and I'm hoping to stimulate more research that way in fat disorders. Because I can't do it all, and we need brains who think differently than me. And Dr. Stutz, and Dr. M, and Dr. M, Dr. M. So are you still awake? Okay, research on other fat disorders. Dr. Maharaj at Bethesda Health City in Boynton Beach, Florida has completed induction for one patient with Madelung's disease. So he induces the stem cells from the bone marrow to grow. It will cost her near the end about $100,000 to do this therapy. She is in our newsletter. Her name is Gail Sylvester DeMello. And she, the Madelung's fat in her upper back is gone. So he's going to submit a research protocol to treat other patients with Madelung's disease. So how cool is that? So because of Gail, there will be a research study on Madelung's disease. Wow. One patient makes a difference. Studies on FML? None. Okay. So the pathophysiology of lipedema, you can read Solnowski's paper. These are my ideas. So either there's a different population of fat stem cells that give rise to this abnormal tissue. There may be an estrogen influence on genetically altered adipose tissue. Or there's something going on in the interstitium. And this is, you know, Dr. Stutz really helped drive this home for me, that this is likely to be true, and how the German surgeons believe this. So it could be that the blood vessels leak more, the lymphatic vessels become overwhelmed, and then they don't pump enough, or they end up leaking. Maybe there's something wrong with the connective tissue. And I think when you heard Steve Norton talk, he kept talking about loss of elasticity in the tissue, and that this tissue just expands, and it just hangs. It doesn't have that pull back that normal tissue has. And I've been working with Laura Sunstein Murphy on this, and there's a connective tissue disorder called Ehlers-Danlos. And many, many, many women who come to see me have hypermobile joints. And if you have hypermobile joints, what are they made of? Connective tissue. So if there's a problem in your joints and your blood vessels and your lymphatics are made of connective tissue, you have a problem, your tissue can't pull back, so it expands. Your blood vessels dilate and leak, and your lymph vessels don't pump quite enough. It answers the whole question of what causes lipedema right there. So that's one very good possibility. And then immune dysfunction, every once in a while I think about it and then I go, I don't know. Maybe, you know. So I wanted to talk about these large fat cells. I mentioned that there are large fat cells in Durkheim's disease. So when you eat, the diameter of your fat cell increases 7 to 10 fold, and its volume increases 300 to 1,000 fold. So I actually drew that out here. Look at that. You have this tiny little fat cell you eat, and that's what it looks like. Is that cool or what? No. What's cool about that? So we know that lipedema has very large fat cells. We know that Durkheim's disease has very large fat cells. We know that Madelung's disease has very large fat cells. These are metabolically changed fat cells. If you look at patients who have diabetes, they have very large fat cells. If you look at patients who have obesity, they have very large fat cells. So if you go and try and biopsy someone with diabetes, can you find an area that has very large fat cells? Just one area specifically? No, you can't. But if you have a lippy lady, you can, right? So wow, we could be useful for, I am one of you. We could be useful for studying obesity, for learning more about diabetes, right? And I think we need to push that in our grants. And I already mentioned that. And I did that too. And then are these large cells able to take in but not release fat? Is there a new set point? They just get big and they go, okay, now that's how we are? And why does the fat remain when people go on low-calorie diets? What the heck? So this is a patient who has lipedema. She's Japanese. Lipedema and other fat disorders are rare in Asians, but she's obviously got lipedema. And they took a biopsy from here as the lip tissue, and then they took one from the groin here as normal tissue. And if you look in the fat, you can see that... there's a big difference. Yeah, you can, I mean, it's clear there's something different, right? So first of all, you can see that these fat cells are right next to their buddy next door. There's no space in between them. They're hugging. This is a group hug here. Here, they don't really like each other that much. They're separating. They're moving apart. And so there's all this stuff in here. And these are purple things with the dots are cells. These are macrophages, which are surrounding the cells. These, it looks like a crown, like an upside down crown, right? So they call them crown-like structures. And in these crown-like structures, there's these proteins that are part of the complement pathway. The complement pathway is involved in clotting, and it's part of the inflammatory process. And one of the tests that I ask people to get if you have lipedema is CH50, and that's, the C stands for complement. And if you are a lippy lady and you're not doing very well, I bet you your CH50 is elevated because you have a lot of inflammation in your tissue. This is also a lot of fibrosis and fluid in between. So that's what your lippy tissue looks like. This is just another way of quantitating it. They colored them in a different way, stained them in a different way. So these are your crown-like structures, not many here, a lot more in lipedema, less than normal. And then they said, okay, so if these fat cells are just sitting there, how are we getting more fat? Are there any cells that are replicating in that tissue? So they stained them with Ki-67, and here are those stains here, the brown little dots. These are cells that are replicating, making new fat cells. You don't see any over here. So there's a lot more replication of fat cells going on in lippy tissue than normal. And then they said, okay, are these adipose stem cells that are replicating? So they stained with CD34 as a marker of adipose stem cells and that Ki-67 to see if they went together, and sure enough, they did. So there is a lot of adipose stem cells replicating in your tissue. And when you have this robust macrophage infiltration and they're surrounding a fat cell, they're killing it. That fat cell is dying, it's dead. They're eating it, right? So there's a lot of death. And then with this replication of cells, there's a lot of birth. So your lippy fat is birth and death all at the same time. There's also this fibrosis, edema, adipocyte hypertrophy, which means big fat cells. And this data has been replicated elsewhere by other investigators. And they saw that not only was there fibrosis between the fat cells, but there was also fibrosis around the arterioles, the small blood vessels, fibrosis and dilation of the small veins, and then these large adipocytes called hypertrophy, or multiple growing adipocytes called hyperplasia. So this is not just one study. This has been duplicated. This is what's happening. This is what it looks like. So let's look at animal studies. If you look at these small fat cells here, you see this really big engorged capillary. And I've outlined that here. But when you get really big fat cells here, look at the size of the capillary. Look how tiny it is. When you have a big capillary, there's this enzyme in it called lipoprotein lipase. And lipoprotein lipase helps you take fat from the blood and take it up into the fat cell to be stored. Because fat cells store fat. They eat sugar, but they store fat. These little capillaries have no lipoprotein lipase anymore. So something has changed. So this is my cartoon of that. Here you've got this normal sized fat cell. It's got this big, robust capillary with all this lipoprotein lipase. Here's fat, and these enzymes are chopping it down so that you can take up these fatty acids and store them as triglyceride. On the cell, you also have the insulin receptor, which binds insulin so you can take up sugar. And then also on here is the beta-adrenergic receptor, which binds epinephrine and norepinephrine. Here's your big fat cell. There's no longer any lipoprotein lipase, so how is the cell surviving? How can it survive? What does it eat? Sugar. That's all it eats, is sugar. So if you eat a high glycemic food, what are you feeding? These guys, right? You're helping maintain these guys. So that's something to think about. If you could mix your carbs so that when you eat a high glycemic carb, you're balancing out with protein and a good carbohydrate, then your glycemic load isn't going to be as high, and you're not going to activate this insulin receptor to have these cells take up sugar. Because when you activate this insulin receptor, it inhibits these two enzymes. And this is hormone-sensitive lipase and adipose tissue triglyceride lipase. And these guys break down the triglyceride into fatty acids so you can get rid of it. If you have a lot of insulin here, the beta-adrenergic receptor, which is binding epinephrine and norepinephrine, doesn't work. You only have sugar coming in. You no longer have breakdown of fat. So the beta-adrenergic receptor is not working. You're not breaking down fat. You're storing triglyceride. That's all you're doing when you take in too much sugar. Okay, so maybe we should be focusing on how this happens. How do we lose this lipoprotein lipase? Also, female fat's different than male fat. So this is a cartoon of female fat. You can see how these septae are up and down. Here's the top of the skin here. Epidermis, dermis, and then fat layers. See how they're nice and elongated? Look at male fat. So if you grow fat here, it just stretches out into the tissue and you don't get those bulges on the surface. But if you have female fat here, the only way to go is up. And so you grow out and you get those bulges on the skin. Also, estrogen. We talked about it. We know nothing about it in lip. We just don't. But estrogen, or we can call it estradiol, that's one of the estrogens, it's very prominent in a female body, binds to this enzyme called nitric oxide synthase. And when it does that, it causes the cell to produce nitric oxide, causes the smooth muscle cells to relax, and the blood vessel dilates. So when you go through puberty, and you already have kind of dilated vessels, all of a sudden your estrogen levels are sky high, all your vessels dilate, you pour fluid into your tissue, your little lymphatics start working, and then they kind of poop out, vroom. You grow, you get fluid in your tissue. When you get fluid in your tissue, your fat cells start to eat it up, take it up, right? And grow, and there's your lip. So dilating the blood vessels increases blood flow and causes tissue edema. What are your sources of estradiol? We always think of the ovaries, right? But you can also convert testosterone to estradiol by this aromatase enzyme. And you can convert testosterone from the adrenals or from the ovaries. You can get testosterone, especially if you have polycystic ovarian syndrome. But also fibroblasts in the body convert testosterone to estradiol, and veins and arteries produce estradiol and estrone. So you don't, even if you have your ovaries removed, maybe there's some change in our vasculature that allows us to produce more estrogen, and right in the area of the fat cells, causing dilation of the blood vessels, leakage, and impairment of the lymphatics. This estrogen may not be detected in the blood. You'd have to do a biopsy of the tissue, which is where our surgeons would come in to help us. So could these, already said that. And then you should read the Solnansky paper for more. Solnansky paper. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Ehlers-Danlos. I know that you guys talk about this on Facebook. it was first described by a couple of Danish dermatologists, Edvard Ehlers, and a French dermatologist, Henry Alexander Danlos. And so that's why it's called Ehlers-Danlos. And make sure you capitalize the D. It's inherited disorders. There's usually a genetic mutation in collagen, so there's a whole bunch of different ones. There's a classic type, a vascular type, and then a hypermobility type, and a couple others. Those are the three most common, though. This derangement in collagen or in the elastic tissue can affect muscle strength, joint motility, and the support of organs and vascular structures.